What's up everyone, Nick here from TV Box Top, and today I'm excited to review a mini PC from one of the earliest brands in the industry. The brand I'm referring to is called Chewy, and for today's video, the team over at Chewy was kind enough to sponsor one of their high-end mini PC models called the Chewy CoreBox. This is their latest Intel i5 12th generation 4.4GHz Deca-Core model sporting 16GB of LPDDR5 RAM, 512GB of M.2 SSD storage, Intel Iris Xe graphics, and running Windows 11. So in this video, I'm going to do a whole lot of exciting stuff to test the boundaries of what it can and cannot do, such as video editing, 4K HDR video playback, Windows gaming, alternative operating systems such as Android x86 and FidoS, RetroArch gaming, and PS2 emulation gaming. So it's going to be a long video. Don't go anywhere. It begins right after this. So let's get started. The box contains the CoreBox mini PC itself, a 19 volts, 3.4 amps, 64 watts DC power supply, one SATA power and data cable, a warranty card, a product inspection report, a certificate of conformity card, and a user manual. For design and I/O ports, at the top, it has a metal plate with the Chewy branding and an Intel Core i5 sticker. Its I/O ports are all located to the rear, and these include one HDMI 2.1 port, one DisplayPort, four USB 3.0 ports, one RJ45GB LAN port, a headphone jack, a microphone jack, and its DC power socket. There is a cooling vent, and the rear panel is made of plastic with a plastic surrounding handle for holding. On both sides, you have exhaust vents. At the front, you have a plastic panel with an LED power button. And to its base, it has two anti-skid rubber strips, vents for its internal cooling fan, and four screws you can remove to gain access to its internal components. So, on the inside, it comes with an AirDisk 512GB NVMe M.2 SSD, and I'll test its read and write speeds in just a moment. It has a large cooling fan and heatsink the size of what you would find in desktop PCs. It has onboard memory and onboard Wi-Fi adapter, and it comes with two SATA connectors to use with the included SATA cable for expandable storage. So for this demonstration, here I installed a 1TB SATA SSD, which I'll be using to install alternative operating systems. So I've already completed the Windows 11 first startup wizard, and here I'm at the Windows desktop. This version of Windows is activated, and let's take a look at its system and hardware information. Here I'm inside Ada 64 Extreme, and it shows that its CPU is the Intel Core i5-1235U and is the Alder Lake model with a boost clock speed of 4.0 GHz. This processor has a total of 10 cores and 12 threads. It has 16GB of LPDDR5 memory. Its GPU is an integrated graphics with a max dynamic frequency of 1.2 GHz. Its audio adapter is the Intel Alder Point HD Audio. For storage, its M.2 NVMe system disk is a 512GB SSD. Here, you can also see the Western Digital 1TB SSD installed as expandable storage. It has an Intel AX201 Wi-Fi 6 adapter that also provides Bluetooth 5.2 support. And that's its basic system and hardware information. For firmware features on the Windows, when connected to my display, which is a 4K television, it can display as high as 3840 by 2160p at 60Hz, but its HDMI port can display as high as 4096 by 2304p at 60Hz. Its display port can display as high as 8K 7680 by 4320p at 60Hz. It has screen orientation to portrait mode, reverse portrait, and reverse landscape. It has HDR display, but it has to be enabled manually. It can play 4K HDR HLG AV1 videos smoothly using the VLC player. Ah. It supports dual monitor display and a third can be connected wirelessly. Video editing in Camtasia is really good, and here I've loaded some 4K 60Hz video clips from this video, and editing its timeline is smooth without throttling. If you connect it to an AV receiver, the options will appear in the audio settings for Dolby and DTS audio. In my testing, it produces all surround sound audio formats such as Dolby Atmos, Dolby Digital Plus, Dolby Surround from Dolby Vision Videos, Dolby True HD, DTS HD Master Audio, and DTS X. Here it produces Dolby Atmos. 10-point accuracy. Next, Dolby Digital Plus.
Or captures the full extent.
With this video, it produces DTS HD Master Audio. This is a Dolby Vision video and it produces Dolby Surround. Here, it produces Dolby True HD.
Next, we have the center channel.
And finally, DTS X. For Windows gaming and testing the performance of its Intel Iris Xe GPU at 4K 2160p resolution, it performs poorly, dropping to as low as 12 frames per second. When set to 1080p resolution, it improves with smoother gameplay at around 32 frames per second. Retro gaming for this core box is a breeze. Running the RetroArch platform, whether it's a Nintendo 64 or PlayStation ROMs, your favorite retro games will play flawlessly. Just remember to change the RetroArch resolution to 1080p.
Thank you. Rocket launcher.
Round 1. Fight!
And as promised, PlayStation 2 emulation gaming works really well on this PC, with internal resolution set to 4x native 1440p or 3x native 1080p, you get speeds up to 100% at 60 frames per second. And that's it for my demonstrations under its Windows operating system. And before I move on to alternative operating systems, let's take a look at its official Windows benchmarks and where it places on my rankings chart. First, its RAM and internal storage read and write speeds. It has a RAM copy speed of 15,005 MB per second. Its internal storage has a read speed of 2,567 MB per second and a write speed of 2,538 MB per second. In testing its Wi-Fi 6 adapter and its Gigabit Ethernet LAN port, based on my network speed of 154 megabits per second, both Wi-Fi bands and the LAN port achieved the maximum speed of my network. In benchmarking, its CPU with Geekbench 5 resulted in a score of 1,513 single-core and 7,229 multi-core. In the Trilimark TimeSpy graphics test, it scored 1,465. In the AnTuTu benchmark, it scored 587,620. And in the PC Mark 10 benchmark, it scored 4,957. And with these benchmarks, it ranks at position number 3 on my mini PC rankings chart. If you would like to view this chart to compare various benchmark scores, see the link in the description below this video. And now onto the final segment where I test alternative operating systems. Well, at least those that I am interested in, such as Android x86, FidoS, and Chrome OS Branch Framework. In testing these operating systems, I was disappointed and at the same time surprised at the results. Firstly, Android x86 could not be installed in any form or fashion as the BIOS blocked the installation with or without secure boot feature. I tried adding EFI boot keys to the installation disk and it still failed. As of the 1st of August 2023, FidoS has released version 17 of the operating system based on the latest Chrome OS update. The app installed without issues and there are minor changes to the interface and a lot more compliance with Google's privacy policies. The app works great, however, I'm still searching for a way to get root access, but as promised, I kept searching and found an alternative. Chrome OS on the Branch framework, on the other hand, is quite exciting for those who are looking for an alternative to FidoS that grants you full access to the Google Play Store, grants you the ability to sideload APKs, and also allows you to install root access unlike FidoS in their recent versions. With the Chewy Core Box, it uses the Briar server build and it delivers outstanding hardware performance. You get Netflix in HD 1080p quality with spatial audio with your subscription, and you get YouTube up to 4K 2160p with HDR. Under this Chrome OS operating system, even though these applications indicate HDR display, it does not trigger the HDR feature on your TV. It has insane benchmarks with gaming performance, allowing you to play any high graphics Android game. One of the surprising discoveries with this Core Box, and I'm unsure if the application is accurate or not, but CPU-Z is showing me that under Chrome OS and Android subsystem, you get 12 cores instead of 10. However, no other application, even Ada 64, can confirm its CPU core information. And finally, for those who have been seeking for a way and an alternative that grants you root access using a special SU application, with the Branch framework, you get to install this app via a rooting process, and it grants you root access to any application you want, and all apps have access to Google Play Services saved data. In summary, the Chewy Core Box i5 is a powerful Windows 11 mini PC, good for both work and entertainment, and there is no doubt about that as it ranks at position number 3 on my rankings chart. However, the issue with this model is its design in relation to I/O ports placement. By locating all the USB ports behind the unit, this makes it a bit frustrating to use if you are constantly plugging in devices. They should have placed at least two ports at the front, and for a Core i5 model, it should have included a USB Type-C display port. With its base clock speed at 1.3 GHz, I was expecting it to be lazy, but this is definitely not the case. Depending on the task, it quickly accelerates to deliver high performance even with difficult tasks such as video editing. Its GPU does not support advanced ray tracing, but it does deliver a good gaming performance once you set the game's resolution to 1080p. So that brings to an end this review. Today's video was sponsored by Chewy, and I would like to thank them for sending their very first product for review. However, the views contained in this video are my own and are meant to deliver as many factual details about the product to my viewers. So if the features and performance of the CoreBox i5 somewhat piqued your interest and you would like to get your hands on one, you won't find this version widely available, and you would have to use the special link provided by Chewy in the description below this video. So thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel to receive notifications about new Android boxes and other great products by clicking the subscribe button and ringing the notifications bell. A video on how to install Chrome OS Branch Framework and how to get root access will be coming soon, so be sure to subscribe to view that video when it's released. I appreciate you taking the time to watch my video. Stay tuned and see you in the next one.